Hello children, we are back with our third video in the optics, and today we are going to deal with special cases of total internal reflection. In the last video we discussed what exactly is total internal reflection, and today we will be seeing total reflecting prisms, and then subsequently we will be discussing optical fibers, also OFCs, which are very significant. Okay, so we will be discussing total reflecting prisms. What is a total reflecting prism? Children, we have already got this idea about total internal reflection, a ray which is traveling from a denser to a rarer medium. If the angle of incidence in the denser medium is more than the critical angle, then the ray undergoes what? Total internal reflection. Keep in mind that the ray has to travel from denser to rarer medium, and angle of incidence in the denser medium has to be more than critical angle. Now we are talking about total reflecting prism. And prism is made of what? Glass. Glass is a refractive index of, let's say, around 1.5. Okay, maybe between 1.5, 2 to 1.4, like that. But let's say it is 1.5. If I consider refractive index of glass, the mean refractive index to be 1.5. then the critical angle will come to be around how much? It will come around 41.8 degrees, which is nearly 42 degrees. That means I can say that if a light ray is traveling from glass into the air, an angle of incidence in the glass is more than 42 degrees, then the ray will be undergoing total internal reflection. So, this is the concept. Okay? The concept is that for glass, critical angle is 42 degrees. And if the angle of incidence in glass is more than 42 degrees, then the ray will be undergoing total internal reflection. Okay? Now, this concept is used for turning a ray by 90 degree or by 180 degree, or for interchanging the rays. That is called what? Self-erection of a prism. Okay? So, let us see what kind of prism we use. For this we use, children, 45 degree by 90 degree by 45. So, you can clearly see this is an isosceles prism. Two angles are 45 degree and one angle is how much? 90 degree. Clear? Now, how this prism work? Internal reflection. So, this is the concept that you are going to use, children. This is the theory for total internal reflection using a prism. Okay. Now, how we can use this prism? Let's see. The first application is turning a ray by 90 degree. How we can turn a ray by 90 degree? For this, we have to do limited geometrical construction. We are using right angle isosceles prism. This angle is 90 degree, this is 45 degree, and this is also 45 degree. Let us see how we are able to turn a ray by 90 degree. We make a light ray incident here at one of the shorter faces. So, I make it incident here at 90 degree, this angle is 90 degree. Now, if this ray is incident at 90 degree along the normal itself, then the ray will not be deviating, it will go straight. It goes straight, will not be deviating at this point. So, let us find out what will happen to this ray now. Suppose the prism is A, B, C. The ray is finally incident on the hypotenuse, which is AC. So, for knowing what will happen to this ray, I must draw a normal at this point. So, at this point I draw a normal. I make a 90 degree angle and draw this normal here. Clear? This angle is how much? 90 degree. Now, if you analyze the angles, children, this is 45, this is 90. So, how much is this angle? This angle is 45. If this angle is 45, then this angle will be how much? This angle will also be 45 degrees. So children, the angle of incidence at this longer face is how much? 45 degrees. And if the angle of incidence here is 45 degrees, then what will happen to the ray? You can clearly see the ray is traveling from denser to rarer medium, and this angle of incidence is more than critical angle. So this ray is going to suffer what? Total internal reflection. So this ray is reflected here, is undergoing total internal reflection, and this angle will be 45 degrees. Children, if this angle is 45 degrees, then how much will be this angle? This angle will be 90. And when a light is incident on a surface at 90 degree angle, it goes undeviated because it's along the normal. So this ray will go straight. So you can clearly see this is ray 1, this is ray 2. And the angle between these two rays is how much? 45 plus 45 is equal to 90 degree. This ray has gone through the other face, other shorter face, and the angle between the first and the second ray, the emergent ray, the incident ray and the emergent ray is how much? 90 degree. So this is what you call is turning a ray by 90 degree. Clear? Now, once you understood this, you should be able to construct this diagram. We will understand how we can turn a ray by 180 degree. This is the second application of this. Turning a ray by 180 degrees. We will see how we can turn a ray by 180 degrees. And for turning a ray by 180 degrees, very easy. What I'll do is, I'll make the ray incident on one of the shorter faces, the longer face, okay, the hypotenuse, okay. Let's see how we'll do this. Let's see, let's construct the ray diagram. This is again the same isosceles prism that we're using. This angle is 90 degrees. This is 45 degrees. This is also 45 degrees. Clear? A ray of light is incident on the longer face at 90 degrees. So if this ray is incident at 90 degrees, what will happen, children? This ray will go straight undeviated. So this ray goes here. So for knowing the fate of this ray, what we'll do is we'll construct what? A normal at this point of incidence. So we make a normal out here. If this is 45 degree, then this angle will also be 45 degree. This angle is obviously more than critical angle, which is 42 degrees. So what will happen? This ray will not be able to emerge. It will be undergoing total internal reflection. This is how this ray will come here on the other face. Again, here we will draw a normal. If we draw a normal, we will find that this angle again is 45 degree. So, if this angle is 45 degree, what will happen to this ray now? This is more than the critical angle. It cannot go into the air out here. So, it will be reflected here. It will be undergoing total internal reflection. This angle will be 45 degree. If this is 45 degree, then clearly you can see this is 90. Because this will be 45, this is 45, 45 plus 45 is 90, so automatically this angle will be how much? 90 degree. So this ray is incident at right angle, so it will go straight. This is ray 1 and this is ray 2. So clearly you can see that angle between the incident ray and the emergent ray is how much? 180 degrees. So we have been very easily able to turn ray by 180 degrees. Clear? You can clearly see that we have been able to turn the ray by 180 degrees. So remember, for turning by 90 degree, the light has to be incident normally, meaning at right angle to one of the shorter faces. For turning by 180 degree, the light has to be incident at right angle on the hypotenuse, the longer side, right? And now number three, the third application is self-erection. This process of self-erection is used for interchanging the rays. In this case, same prism. Here you have a prism, 90, 45, and this is 45. Clear? Now a light is incident here at one of the shorter faces parallel to the base. This ray is undergoing total internal reflection out here. It will be refracted and this will be undergoing total internal reflection. After undergoing total internal reflection, the ray comes here and from here it will be emerging parallel to the base. Clear? This is ray 1. Now the second ray is incident out here. This will be refracted at this point. Clear? And then this angle of incidence out here will be more than critical angle. So the ray will be undergoing total internal reflection and coming out at this point. This is ray 2, so this is 2. Okay, if I place an object AB out here, okay, this is A and this is B. One is representing A, B is representing 2. Then you can see that one has gone up, this is 1, this is 2. So it becomes something like this, AB. If this is the head, you can see the head is inverted. So by using this prism, this position of the 45 by 90 by 45 prism, we are actually able to interchange these two rays. Out here you can see, this is called self-erecting prism. Okay. So we saw the three applications of the prism in case of total internal reflection. I hope you understood it. Now we are discussing optical fiber cable. Okay. We'll understand, children, what is optical fiber. The concept is very simple. In fact, what I said earlier, if the angle of incidence on for a ray traveling from glass into the air is more than 42 degrees, then the ray will undergo what? Total internal reflection. This is the basic concept. In optical fiber, what we see is, in fact, we have two concentric pipes. One pipe is here. This pipe is called core. These are fine pipes. They are thinner than even a hair also, having size very thin. Clear? In fact, these days the application of optical fiber cables or OFC has really revolutionized the communication technology altogether. Whether it's telephony or whether it's transmission of images, is finding tremendous application and fast replacing the old cable connections. Okay, so we have one glass cable inside. This glass cable is made up of material having greater refractive index, and it is surrounded by another concentric pipe having greater refractive index. Okay. The outer pipe is called cladding. This is called cladding, and the inner pipe is called core, CORE core. And then there is a plastic buffer on the top of protecting this, but that has nothing to do with total internal reflection or how the optical fiber works. Now, children, what happens is that the inner layer which you see out here, it has greater refractive index, and the outer one has got what? Smaller refractive index. For example, the inner glass is a refractive index of mu 1 is equal to 1.52, And this outer glass has a refracting index of mu is equal to nearly 1.48, which is less. Now imagine a situation where a light will be incident here, and the angle of incidence here is more than 42 degrees. So what will happen? This ray will not be able to emerge. This ray will be trapped inside, and finally, so this is how every time this beam of light is incident on the glass pipe, it's suffering total internal reflection. And the beautiful thing is that whatever the intensity of the signals out here, the same is the intensity of the emergent signals, and we can assume that there is almost 100% transmission and very little loss of signal as the signal is traveling through the glass pipe. Clear? So an optical fiber is basically an arrangement based on total internal reflection. It consists of two concentric or two coaxial pipes. Coaxial meaning they have the same axis here. Axis is same. Clear? The inner glass pipe has greater refractive index is called core. And the outer glass pipe, which is slightly what smaller, refractive index is called cladding. And then there is a buffer insulation also here on the top. But that is not discussion, a part about discussion. There is a plastic insulation, is called buffer insulation on the top. Okay? To protect it from weather conditions, we put a plastic cover on the top. Clear? So the ray which is entering the glass pipe from one end has angle of incidence more than the critical angle, and therefore it will be suffering multiple total internal reflection, and finally it will emerge at the other end undiminished. So the advantage is the intensity of the transmitted what light will be same as the intensity of the incident light. So let's write about what exactly is an optical fiber. End of the rod. So this is the simple definition. An optical fiber consists of a pair of coaxial glass rods. Inner pipe, known as core, has greater refractive index, whereas the outer pipe, known as cladding, has what? Lower refractive index. And the working is, it works on the principle of TIR, total internal reflection. A light ray incident at one end of the rod undergoes multiple total internal reflection through the glass rod and emerges undiminished at the other end of the rod. Now this has got tremendous applications. You are seeing everywhere OFCs are being used. So what are applications of this, children? Applications are in communications. In communication, then we have in transmission of images. We can transmit what? Images using this. In transmission of electromagnetic waves of electromagnetic waves, then a bunch of pipes known as light what pipes can be used for studying the inner part of our stomach called endoscopy. Okay, so in endoscopy, these are very important applications of optical fibers, and they are being extensively used in research work. So these are some of the applications, and these applications have become so vital that today we cannot do without optical fiber cable. They are fast replacing the conventional telephonic cables. The advantage is that the signals pass and diminish. There is no loss of signals. Whatever the input intensity, nearly same is the intensity of the output signals at the other end of the optical fiber cables. Clear? So this was, we studied some of the applications of total internal reflection. Okay. Now children, we'll be discussing reflection to curved surfaces, which is an important topic, important derivation also for you. Reflection through curved surfaces. Now a curved surface, we can consider like a glass. It can be either a convex surface, it can be what? Concave surface. So, we are going to discuss the first thing, which is reflection of light through a concave curved surface, case 1. Reflection through a convex surface, convex curved surface. Let's say this case, reflection through a convex curved surface. Imagine we have a convex surface out here. Now this surface has got what? A pole as well. Suppose this is the pole and this is the principal axis. Clear? Now this curved surface has got what? A center that we call center of curvature. Suppose the center of curvature is here. See. Clear? We are going to assume that the object is in the rarer medium, then obviously the glass will become what? The denser medium. We will assume the refractive index of the surrounding medium is mu 1 and the refractive index of glass is how much here? Mu 2. This is the glass surface. This is the glass surface. Clear? Now, this is pole P. From object O, let's take two rays. One ray is passing through the pole. So this will be what? Go undeviated. Let's take another ray, which is incident at some point M on the spherical surface or on the curved surface. So what will happen to this ray? This ray is going from rarer to denser, so it will be bending towards the normal. So the question is, where is the normal? The answer is, for locating the normal, I will join with the center of curvature. Suppose center of curvature is here, C. So this will become normal. This is the incident ray. Now this ray is traveling from rarer to denser. So after reflection, it is bending towards the normal. So it is bending here. So you can see that one ray which is traveling through the pole and the other ray which is being refracted here, they are meeting at point I. So I will become the real image. Clear? So I will become real image of object O. Now we are making certain assumptions. I will consider this angle as alpha. I will consider this angle as beta. And I will consider this angle as gamma. Clear? At this point is M we have taken. From M, I'll drop a perpendicular on the principal axis. So let's drop this. This is a normal on the principal axis. Let's say this normal is, this angle is how much up? 90 degrees. Here we'll make one assumption, and you should remember this, that point N will be taken very close to the pole, because you know that all the distances are measured from the pole. So it's important for me to assume that N is very close to the pole. Clear? Let's understand this. O is a point object which is kept in the radar medium. A refractive index of the surrounding medium is mu 1 and that of the curved surface is mu 2, right? And then we consider two rays. One ray is going through the pole, it will go straight. See the center of curvature, and you very well know this distance will be taken as what? Radius. Right? And then the other ray which is incident at point M is bending towards the normal, and these two rays, one through the pole and the other is the reflected ray, they are meeting at I, so I is the real image. Clear? And then you have taken these angles to be alpha, beta and gamma. Now we have to relate I and R. This angle is angle of incidence I, this angle of incidence R. Clear? Sign convention I have already done in the lower classes, that all the distance will be measured from the pole. Distances on the right will be taken as positive and left will be taken as what? Negative. Above will be taken as positive and below will be taken as what? Negative. The same as Cartesian sign you have done. This O is the origin. Distances on the right are positive, left are negative. Above are positive and below are negative. Same convention we are using. Once again, distance on the right will be taken the right of. The pole is positive, left is what? Negative. Above is positive and below is what? Negative. Same convention I am going to use. And I am saying object distance is u. And the image distance is v. So image is here. The distance is v. Clear? So let's write about this. Let I the real image of object O and angles I and R angles of incidence and refraction. Now using Snell's law, children, if I use, then sin I divided by sin R is equal to mu 2 1, and how much is that? Mu 2 by mu 1. Clear? Now, we also have to assume one thing, more thing, that Mn is perpendicular such that points M N and P are nearly coincident. Now it's very important for us to assume this, that these are nearly coincident. Sin of I by sin of R is mu 2 1, which is mu 2 by mu 1. You have already done. Now you have also done, we have to make a lot of assumptions here. Like one assumption is here that points N and P should be nearly coincident. But why we have to say no nearly coincident? Because all the distance is actually measured from P and not from N. Okay. When N and P will be nearly same, then we can measure, we can replace N by P, and that will be also correct as per the standard rule that all the distances will have to measure from the pole. That's why N and P should be coincident. Now sin of I by sin of R is equal to mu 2 by mu 1, and you know for small angles sin theta will be nearly equal to theta. Now this is an important assumption here, approximation. Then sin theta will be nearly equal to theta. So you can write here sin I as I. This implies that I by R is equal to mu 2 by mu 1. And from here what do we get? I into mu 1 is equal to R into mu 2. This is equation 1. Now children, from the given diagram, I'll have to calculate INR, and INR will have to be calculated in terms of alpha, beta and gamma. Let's understand this. Now, for this angle I, I is the external angle for what? Alpha and beta. So you can say that I will be equal to how much? Alpha plus beta. Yes. Now we'll say I is equal to alpha plus beta. What the reason? External angle. Alert full. External angle. Because you have done, no? External angle is equal to sum of internal angles. So, I is equal to alpha plus beta. This is equation 2. Similarly, children, beta is the external angle for what? R and gamma. So, beta will be equal to how much of? R and gamma. Again, I'll say R plus gamma is equal to beta. Same region. External angle. So how much is R? Beta minus gamma. So what I'll do now, children? I'll put in the values of I and R in equation 1. Okay? I'll say here. Put in the values of I and R in which equation? Equation 1. So what did I get? I get I mu 1 and I is how much of alpha plus beta. So alpha plus beta into mu 1 is equal to R. R is how much of beta minus gamma. Neat. Clear? Now let's simplify this. This is alpha mu 1 plus beta mu 1 is equal to beta mu 2 minus gamma mu 2. Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to bring this gamma on the left and I'm going to take this beta on the right. So I can get here alpha mu 1 plus gamma mu 2 is equal to beta mu 2 minus beta mu 1, and I can write this as gamma mu 2 plus alpha mu 1 is equal to mu 2 minus mu 1 into beta. We got gamma mu 2 plus alpha mu 1 is equal to mu 2 minus mu 1 into beta. And then again we are going to make one more approximation, just like we said for small angle sin theta is equal to theta. Similarly, I'll say here, for small angle theta, theta is nearly equal to tan theta. Now I'm going to make use of this expression. So what I'm trying to imply is, we can replace gamma with tan gamma, and we can replace alpha with tan alpha, and we can replace beta with tan beta. If I make use of this, then I'll get here mu 2 tan gamma plus mu 1 tan alpha is equal to mu 2 minus mu 1 tan beta. Clear, children? And now I'll be substituting the values of tan alpha, tan beta and tan gamma. Let's see tan gamma. Tan gamma will be, we have mn divided by ni. Let's write mn divided by ni plus mu 1 tan alpha. Tan alpha is mn divided by OP OP is equal to mu 2 minus mu 1, and tan beta is A1 divided by NC. So what we can do? We can cancel out MN, MN, MN from both sides. And then I can say mu 2 upon NI. But I will not be saying NI now. N is same as P. So NI will be same as PI plus mu n upon OP is equal to mu 2 minus mu n by NC. NC will be same as PC. Okay. Now let's use the sign convention, children. If I measure on the left, then PO will be minus U. It's on the left, it is what? Negative. PC is on the right, will be plus R. And PI is also on the right, will be plus V. PI is equal to plus V. So remember these three measurements. Plus V. Once again, PO is on the left, so negative, that's minus U. PC is on the right, so it's plus, plus R. PI is also on the right, so it is plus V. So I put all these values out here. So what do I get? I get mu 2 by PI. And how much is PI? V. Mu 2 by V plus mu 1 by minus U is equal to mu 2 minus mu 1 by R. So children, this is an important equation that we got for refraction on a curved surface when the surface is convex and the object is kept in a rarer medium. Clear? Now we'll be modifying it for, we can modify it for the situation when the object is in the denser medium. When the object is in denser medium, we'll just be interchanging mu 1 by mu 2 and mu 2 by mu 1. Okay. I'll show you how we can modify when the object is in the denser medium. Okay.